Hi, I'm Lizzie.
And my name is Hayden. And we're really excited to be here today. We're giving you the marriage talk today. So just a little bit about us. We actually met at a camp the summer before our senior year. So I guess you could call us high school sweethearts.
So we're from different high schools. We went to this camp together, and because our teachers just decided it would be a cool camp for us to go to. And so we did. We met. We started dating our senior year in high school. And then we also went to separate colleges. So we kind of had a long-ish, but not really, relationship until our wedding day, really.
Right. So really after 5 years of dating, after much discernment and prayer, I decided to get down on one knee and propose to Lizzie. And a year later, after all the pre-canon work and all, we got married. And, yeah, it's been awesome.
Yeah, and fun fact about us, if you want to call it fun, is so whenever I was born and my parents were together, I had my first communion. My dad was Catholic, but my mom grew up Protestant. And so whenever they got divorced, my mom got custody of me and my siblings. We actually went to a Protestant church. And so I converted to be a Protestant, and I was actually Protestant when I met Hayden. And so I wasn't able to go through RCIA before we got married just because of logistic reasons. But so technically, like, you know, people ask, like, can, you know, non-Catholics get married in the Catholic Church? And
the answer is yes.
The answer is yes, because we were the example of that. And I went to RCIA after we were married, but, you know.
And me, I was cradle Catholic in the very beginning. I wasn't really into my faith. But when you started dating a Protestant girl, you were really drilled.
You asked a lot. Questions.
Yeah, I got tons of questions. So it was really awesome because I actually had to get deeper in my faith and really take ownership of it. So it was definitely a challenge, but an awesome challenge and really something that we grew from.
Yeah. So here we are 3 years later. We don't have kids, if you're wondering, but we do have this really awesome, like, lazy bump on a log
does
dog.
Nothing.
Yeah, it does nothing.
My kind of dog.
Yeah, Jenny.
So. Yeah. So our talk is about marriage. And the first thing to realize is that marriage is a sacrament.
Yeah, and when we say sacrament, it's an external sign of something sacred that, like, imparts grace. So you get to see a sacrament every single Sunday with communion. So on the outside, you see what looks like bread, but its actual substance is Jesus' body after transubstantiation occurs on the altar.
And, you know, the external sign for us is our rings. Show your blink. Look at that. You know, on the outside, they just look like little chunks of metal. But really, they're there to represent our marriage and the vows that we made on our wedding day in front of our families, friends, and the priest, and God himself. And I always thought our priest really kind of talked into, you know, I'm a math guy. So our priest started talking about the shape of the ring and how it's a circle. And the cool thing with circles is that it's a never-ending line. There's never a break in the circle. So it's really cool because our external symbol is a line or something that never breaks, which is our commitment and our love for each other.
Yeah, so for the sacrament of marriage, the external symbol is the exchanging of vows and the exchanging of rings. And the grace is whenever grace gives us the ability to fulfill our duties as this life together, you know, being able to lead each other into holiness as a married couple and, you know, be able to, the grace to raise a family, God willing, whenever that time comes for us.
And what's really unique about the sacrament is that this is like the only sacrament where we actually administer this to each other. I administer when it was our wedding day, we went up on the altar and we administered our vows and the priest was there as a witness. While other sacraments like baptism, anointing the sick, reconciliation, the priest administers the sacrament. So it's really cool that this is the one sacrament where you get to do the administering. I guess that's a word, huh?
Yeah. Administering to each other. Yeah. Do you mind grabbing the Bible or the Bible app? Okay. So marriage is mentioned all over the Bible. I mean, God starts off the Bible talking about marriage. Between Adam and Eve, and it ends the Bible in Revelations when it talks about the marriage supper of the Lamb. So intentionally, you know, the Bible begins and ends talking about marriage. And even going farther, like the very first miracle that Jesus ever did of his ministry was at the wedding of Cana, whenever he turned water into wine. And then the last verse that I want to share with you is found in Ephesians chapter 5. And you guys probably heard of this, but just bear with me. In Ephesians chapter 5, starting verse 25, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Let me repeat that. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Even so, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no man ever hates his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is a profound one, and I am saying that refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband.
Yeah, we can really see in that verse that God does not take marriage lightly. And since God doesn't take marriage lightly, the Catholic Church does not take it lightly. Marriage is meant to be undissolvable. And it's a permanent bond. And it's, because of that, it's considered sacred, and if validly ordained. And when I say validly ordained, recognized by the church, there are about four topics, but we'll get into that a little bit later.
Yeah, so whenever Hayden and I discerned, okay, we're going to get married, well, then we had to start pre-Cana. And so pre-Cana, typically at minimum, is six months. And so one of the very first things we did is, all right, we found the priest to do our preparation. And one of the first things he did was we had to do this crazy long questionnaire. I mean, and this questionnaire was thorough.
They made it seem like a test. Like, if you don't pass, yeah, you can't get married. But
yeah, I mean, the goal was to get as much right. And like, you know, because I took it and he asked for me to take it privately. So I took it on my own time and I told Hayden, because of course, you know, I took it first and, you know, slacker over here. I'm like, hey, make sure that, you know, make sure you take this test. You know, we have a meeting with Father Michael.
And test.
I know. And so we went through this crazy long test. And of course, it took me like an hour. It took him like 10 minutes, you know, just naturally. It took you longer than 10 minutes. I took it seriously. But
I'm just serious though.
Anyway, so we go through this long questionnaire, and then we sit down with this priest, and he went through all the stuff we didn't answer the same. And surely enough, the very first meeting that we have with this priest, he brings the most tense topic
at that moment in our relationship.
And he had no clue what it was. And so very first pre-Cana meeting, and wow.
It was a rough one.
Man, that was a little rough. But, you know, but the whole point is to be able to work through things like that. And so we did, and we went through our other meetings with our priest, and talking about things that they need to talk about, you know, preparing us. And we went to this weekend retreat called Engaged Encounter. And there was other couples there who were engaged. And they and there's a, some other married couples there to kind of counsel you through the weekend, and they talk through these certain topics, ranging from, you know, spiritual life and spiritual food and how to be a good wife and husband, finances, kids, like all this huge array of topics. And it was honestly super powerful and we loved it. But that's kind of what you're getting into whenever you are preparing for marriage in the Catholic Church.
I guess, like, for me, you know, whenever I thought of a wedding, the only really experience I had before our wedding was non-Catholic weddings. So, like, every single time you see a TV show and the couple ends up getting married, the groom goes up there, bride comes up, they exchange vows, give each other rings, and the pastor says, all right, you're now married, they kiss, end of the thing. It seems like 5 minutes, and it runs by. So when we went to pre-Cana and we were talking about our wedding, it, like, when he asked me, when are we doing, you know, for communion, when are we doing that? I'm like, wait, there's a whole mass? You know, and at first I'm like, oh my gosh, this is going to be a long wedding. But it was also just super exciting because, like, in the moment during our wedding, it was so awesome that it was, you know, it was such Christ-centered. And we really, it was, you just felt God there uniting us as one. And I like, no, like during communion, I got to be a Eucharist minister and minister to our guests, I guess you could say.
Yeah.
And then, you know, with Lizzie not being Catholic at that point, she got her blessing and then she went back on the altar and kneeled during the whole time. And
And so when I was kneeling on the altar, I felt like someone came and knelt next to me. I felt like something physical next to me. And so, I mean, I was praying up to that point, my eyes were closed, and then I kind of felt it, and I opened my eyes, and I looked to the side, and there was no one there. And, like, to me, it was just so evident that Jesus was present in this ceremony.
And he was really uniting us as one. It was just awesome. And, you know, some other cool things that, if you, you know, getting married in the Catholic Church, that's a time where you actually get to receive the gifts, being the offering. So you get to accept those, and then you actually get to kneel on the altar right in front of when those gifts turn into the body and blood of Christ. So it's just such an awesome ceremony, and it's so beautiful. So I guess talking about goals of marriage, I know all of us have in our head what, you know, we have an idea of what the perfect marriage is. We just have this couple that we know that they just exemplify a great marriage. And for me, it's my grandparents. My parents are awesome married couple too, but my grandparents, they've been married for over 50 years. And, you know, they've gone through some really tough times, but they've always decided to stick with each other and choose each other and love each other. And, you know, my grandpa, he's a mess, but he always refers to, as my grandma, as his bride. Like, when we go out to eat, everybody knows you do not sit in the chair next to him because that's for his bride. Mm-hmm. Whenever we're on vacation, he's always asking the tour guide, like, you know, is this going to make my bride happy? And just seeing that love for his bride is just so awesome. And, you know, we all have this idea of a perfect marriage. And when I decided to, you know, when I went through the discernment and I decided I wanted to marry Lizzie, you know, one of the goals I had set in my head is that I need to learn how to love Lizzie almost as much as Jesus loves the church, which I know that's not possible because none of us are perfect, but I need to try at least do my best to love her as Jesus loved the church.
Yeah, and by choosing marriage, like, you're choosing to partner with someone for the rest of your life, and this person's flawed, and they're imperfect, and they're going to be constantly changing. I know from, I mean, I met Hayden when I was in high school, and so sure enough, 5 years later, after graduating college, I was not the same person, thankfully, and even from saying I do to today, I'm not the same person. I mean, I'm going to change, Hayden's going to change. We're constantly going to be changing our entire lives, and we're constantly making mistakes. And so you're making a commitment to a person that is flawed and imperfect, because it's not like you're marrying God. I mean,
I'm not perfect.
I mean, it's not like you're marrying God. I mean, it's not like, like, you're a sister who's solely committed to God. It's just not the same. You're marrying an imperfect human being who's going to disappoint you and upset you. And that's perfectly fine. That's part of the beauty of marriage. I mean, that's part of the grace that I talked about earlier in getting married. And you have to be willing that, you know, this person's going to change and you are going to stick with them no matter what. And because even in the vows, it talks about, you know, through sickness and through health and for richer and poorer, for better or for worse. I mean, the whole point of, like, you're meant to be unified as a married couple, and when you stick with those vows, that's what you're achieving. You're achieving unification.
Yeah, and like Lizzie Hinton, marriage is not always easy. Every single married couple we talk to always says, like, the first year is always brutal. You know, luckily we didn't have that. First year was awesome for us, but I mean, we still had disagreements and we still had things that we had to overcome. But, you know, one of the best tips of advice someone told us is that never go to bed angry. Or in disagreement. So when those disagreements did come up, we had to stop and say, all right, you know, we had to realize that we are on the same team, we had the same goal, get each other to heaven. And, you know, we took those disagreements, we prayed with God about it, and God really is that glue that keeps marriages together. You can look at all the stats. Married couples that attend church together, their marriages are so much more successful than those that don't attend church together.
Right. And something else that's in our vows and that I really had to get comfortable with is, you know, whenever you're getting married in a Catholic church, I mean, you have to be open to procreation. You have to be open to having a family on God's timing. And so this thing that the Catholic Church supports is called natural family planning, and which we'll refer in this video as NFP to shorten it. And it's, people call it Catholic birth control, but it's not, that's not the same thing. It's not a pill or anything like that. It's just a way that, you know, the wife's cycle gets tracked to figure out fertility and infertility, and you plan your family using that as a tool.
So earlier we kind of talked about, you know, the four things that the church looks for to make a marriage valid. And the first one is freedom. You know, we don't have arranged marriages in the Catholic Church.
No.
But
thankfully,
you know, we're not arranged. So basically, when both the bride and groom decide to get married, they have to kind of they have to tell the priest that they're not being forced into this marriage. And I think it's, you know, just it's such a great reminder, because, you know, one of the gifts that God gave us is this gift of free will. He didn't want us to be just robots all the time, and we get to exercise that free will when we decide to get married, because we get to say, all right, am I willing? And it's my choice to join this person, holy matrimony, and really become united as one.
Yeah. The second quality is it has to be total. So total meaning that, like, each spouse is going to give themselves totally to one another, and not hold anything back. So essentially what that means is, I mean, yeah, your spouse gets to become your best friend, and, you know, they get to be there when times are awesome and you celebrate, but also, like, the times of, like, shame and regret, those get shared with them also. And so your spouse has to be someone that you can go to, even though you don't want to tell them certain things, you can go to them and you know they're going to choose you regardless. And they're going to choose you the next day.
The next one is faithfulness. And when you decide to get married and you have to promote that you're going to be faithful to your spouse, you're committing to that person for the rest of your life and theirs. And unfortunately, in this world, we see a lot of marriages being ruined due to just this quality not being upheld. And guys, it's very tough with all the media and all the outside influences. And it's challenged, but it's such a great gift to show your other spouse. Because when you go on that altar on your wedding day, God unites you into one flesh and one soul. And we know that what God makes cannot be broken.
Yeah, and the fourth quality is fruitful. So every marital life must be open to new life coming from it. So, like, earlier when I said a little bit harder for me to swallow is because I want to, you know, I want to control and I want to plan. And, you know, an NFP, it just leaves that room for God to do his work. I mean, you're not putting a barrier in the way in order for new life to come from your marriage. But this is also why the church only recognizes, you know, marriage to be between a man and a woman. You know, a man and a woman's body are made for each other in order to be fruitful. And fruitful is one of those qualities that the Catholic Church looks for in order to consider a marriage valid. So with all that being said, like, we just dumped so much information on you.
And some of you probably aren't thinking you're going to get married within a year or so, but
yeah,
you probably got some time before marriage.
You know, you're probably thinking people are crazy if they decide to get married.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. I don't blame you. I don't blame you.
That was a little crazy.
But whenever... What?
I didn't say that. Go ahead.
I'm going to act like I didn't hear anything. So whenever you're discerning marriage, so just like if you're discerning priesthood, you go to seminary. I mean, yeah, you pray about being a priest, but, you know, you actively take actions to discern it, and you go to seminary. If you want to become a nun, you can go to a convent. You can visit with sisters and figure out your path. So to discern marriage, you have to date. That is one of the things in order for you, one of the physical things you can do in order to discern you know, this is the vocation for you. And the way that the tool that God wants to use in order for you to become holy and sit with him in heaven.
And just one thing that we really want to stress to all of you is that God has a plan for each and every one of you to achieve that holiness. So something that you can really do right now, if you feel like marriage is going to be your vocation in the future, we really invite you to pray, not just for yourself to grow into the spouse that God wants you to become, but also just for your future spouse, that, you know, they follow God's plan and, you know, God wants that you'll both end up meeting each other and decide to get married. And also, you know, I know it's really early to do this, but start praying for your family and kids, God willing, that you're gifted with those children, that you get to be the leader and really lead them on the path to heaven. So, well, I think we're good, huh?
We're good.
That's marriage.
So that's like the tiniest peephole into marriage.
But guys, thank y'all so much, and God bless.